Men, women, black or white, we are all entitled to a second chance. We all deserve the right to due process or fair treatment through the normal judicial system. But above all else, we deserve our story to be told. This is the story of Charles Green Miller. In his early childhood, Miller lived with his grandmother as sharecroppers. He didn't spend much time in school, but through the years he learned to read and write. In his older years, Miller lived a simple life in his Opelika home with his wife Rosalie and one roommate. He held steady work at the railroads, working long hours and days. The work was dangerous and required heavy labor. The Great Depression took a toll on his work, lowering wages and increasing unemployment rates. Not only did it impact Miller, it also affected other railroad industrial workers in Alabama. According to Lee County Sheriff William Samuel Buck Jones, he saw Miller as a good fellow. Charles Miller's life took a turn for the worse in the summer of 1932. According to news reports at the time, Charles Miller allegedly destroyed his entire house and slit his wife's throat on June 29, 1932. Afterwards, he traveled to his brother-in-law's with a shotgun. Miller then attempted to shoot his brother-in-law and his wife. We do not know why here, but we do know he wanted to scare them. They only suffered minor injuries because he fired into a nearby tub where their hands were, not directly at them. A few hours later, Sheriff Buck received a call detailing where Miller would be found and offered to go and speak to Miller. As he left, he reportedly said, "He's a good fellow. He won't give me any trouble." The connection between Sheriff and Miller remains unknown. When the sheriff opened the door, he was shot in the chest and died shortly after. It is at this time, according to the sheriff's family, Miller reportedly said, "Oh, Mr. Buck, I didn't know it was you." He then fled the scene. Shortly after the news of the death of Sheriff Buck, a mob formed to kill Miller. They shot him between 100 to 150 times and, quote, tore him to pieces. His body was then left on the steps of the courthouse. This is important because the mob wanted everyone to see what they had done to Miller. Similar to most lynchings and hate crimes, it was not only a form of punishment to the victim, but a message of terror to other people not to step out of line. In addition, by leaving Miller in front of the courthouse, it solidified their ideology that they were serving justice for the death of the sheriff. It was also important to add that because Miller was killed before he received the right of due process, we will never know why or if he even killed his wife and threatened to harm his brother and sister-in-law. The legacy Charles Miller left in the Opelika community has been controversial since the incident 88 years ago. Sheriff Jones died embraced as a hero, protecting the town he loved. Miller, on the other hand, died seen as a murderer. However, we can't be sure of what really transpired. Technically, he was never found guilty and therefore died an innocent man, but the mob that shot him roughly 100 times got to go home, see their families, and go to work the next day when no one thought anything of it. Opposed to the belief that he deserved his fate, Miller never received the opportunity as an American citizen of due process. Without the rule of a judge, we will never understand Miller's case to the full extent. We will never know Miller's relationship with his wife, his brother-in-law, his sister-in-law, and Sheriff Jones. Miller's fate was instead decided out of the oppressive tyranny enforced by the white mob. This tragedy is important not only to Opelika, but to all of America because it compels you to think critically about what it means to die without justice, to die without your story being heard. If you take nothing else from this story, walk away knowing that true justice does not discriminate.